Now then, hello world, hello Facebook, hello church family, good to see you today, good to see everyone. Tech guy, Darren, so I have a real tough job for you to do, so I want you to undo all that we've done, and but leave the sound plugged. Just do a sweep of the room so everybody can see. They can see who's here. You have to turn the knob on top, just like that. Unplug the power, yeah, but leave the sound in, and just kind of do a sweep of the room. So start way in the back, get Mary Kay and Kristen and Anthony, there you go. Yep, everybody give them a wave. Hello world, yep. Good, keep on going. Good job. Pay attention to the seats as well as you're watching all of this good stuff. So, awesome. All right. Okay, give Darren a chance to get that put back together, and hopefully you didn't get too sick as the camera's shaking and moving and all that good stuff, but like to show you who's here, like you see the seating arrangement, and hope that you got that. So let me kick off officially. Hey, welcome Alpena First Assembly and Ossineke First Assembly of God Church. We are glad you joined with us today. And I am particularly thrilled on this particular Sunday. Why is that? Because today is Pentecost Sunday. Well, what is Pentecost Sunday? Well, it takes place 50 days after the resurrection. And it is when the outpouring of the Holy Spirit happens that we read about in Acts chapter 1 and Acts chapter 2. And so that will be the theme of the message today. So I'm really excited about that. And I want you to celebrate with us today. And so we're going to go through a couple of announcements. I'm going to pray in just a couple of moments, and we're going to continue on with our service. We're going to worship the message, and Susie's going to be here today. So a really exciting day. But let's start off with our announcements. And so let's see. What's the first thing that we have coming up today? Welcome. Hey, we did that. Good job. And let me see while I'm thinking about it. So next Sunday, this is our last Sunday and this Sunday, is kind of our soft opening. We're just kind of working through the bugs, working through the mask, working through the gloves, trying to get everyone educated, all that. We're thrilled that you are here, those of you that are here in person and those of you who are watching. But next Sunday, we are inviting everyone to attend. Everyone to attend. And so, bugs and wrinkles worked out. We have gloves, we have masks, we have sanitizing stations, we have all of that. And so what you've seen last Sunday and this Sunday will be the typical Sunday morning service. We're looking for about between 45 minutes and an hour for a typical Sunday morning service. And so we invite you to be here next Sunday live. Hallelujah. And like I've been saying for the last 3 months, I can't wait to see you face to face. And I am so excited to see so many faces here today. Let me tell you, quite honestly, I got to learn how to preach all over again. last Sunday I was preaching, I kept looking at the camera, and I'm doing that now, but I forgot I had people in the building last Sunday, and so different from what I'm accustomed to. So anyway, we want to say thank you for being here, thank you for watching. Here's our church reopen plan. We have it up here, we have it over here. News on that is next Sunday, everyone invited, and so we invite you to be a part as well. And so remember your tithe and offering. We're not receiving tithe and offering as such as we have in the past. Right now we just have a bucket put in the back, and really what we're just trying to do is eliminate all the touches. And so if you bring your tithe and offering in person, we just have a bucket, and you can just put it back there in the back. It's a Home Depot bucket with a sign on it, so you can do that as well. And if you're giving online, then please continue to do that. Summer picnics, we are going to go ahead and tentatively schedule those in case unless something else happens. And so those will be going on this summer, the last Wednesday night, June, July, and August, just like we've always done. And then, if you missed it, simplest place to find it, you can find it on Facebook, but the simplest place is at our YouTube channel. So just go to YouTube, search Alpena First Assembly, you'll find all of our videos, information, or you can also go to the church website, www.alpenafirstassembly.org or www.ossinekefirstassembly.org. Either one of those will get you to that place. Just go to the messages tab and you'll find that. And then is that it? Two for two in hope? We because everyone needs hope, amen? And so let me encourage you just to continue to reach out. Anything else, Amanda, or is that it? That's it right there? Okay, good. So those are our announcements. I want to open with prayer. And so if you would just bow your heads and your hearts, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. Father, today we are so thankful. We appreciate the presence of God in our lives. Lord, we are so thankful that we don't have to try to get you to come down. We don't have to try to get you to show up. That you are in the heart and the life of every believer. Every person who has surrendered their life to you, who have submitted themselves to the cross of Christ, Lord, you fill them with your Spirit, and we ask, God, that your Spirit would just do an incredible work in us. Lord, that you would renew our minds and our hearts today. Now, Lord, we ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you for praying with us. At this time, the praise and worship team is going to come, and they're going to lead us in worship. And as they are making their way up here, the first song that we're going to sing, I think, is so appropriate for today. How many of you know that if you've watched the news, there's this incredible, incredible problem in our society? It's called racism. And I'm just going to call it out plain. Racism is a sin. The Bible never anywhere promotes racism. It promotes the imago Dei, the image of God in every person. Every person made in the image of God. Not only is every person made in the image of God, God is a God of justice. And there has been tremendous injustice. Now listen, there's been other injustices that are being performed now through the rioting. And we should never promote or encourage rioting. Those people who are doing rioting are just thugs. And if you think a thug is someone who is black, then you have a thug is someone who does violence. Okay? Those people are thugs. And as I think about this song we're going to sing, I think of two great things that are converging together. I think one, this song says that you are the God of this city. But two, I think on Pentecost Sunday, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit was given to empower people to change the world. Listen, not just to change a person, but to change the world. And if we don't get a hold of that truth, that God comes in and changes our life, and in part so we can change the world. Church, we have a big responsibility. And it is ever so evident, hour that when we look out across the world and we can see people who are being killed traumatically, terribly, and the church needs to be about the Father's business, sharing the gospel so that hearts are changed. So that lives are changed. So I invite you today to worship with us as we sing this song. You are the God of this city. But don't just sing the words. I want you to think of how all that God has done, not only from sending his Son, but sending the Holy Spirit to empower us to be witnesses. Let's worship together.
The hopeless, You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of the city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. For greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done here.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There
name of Jesus, there is power, power in his name. One name can save, one name breaks every chain, one name always, one name Jesus, one name remains, one name we will proclaim, one name always, one name. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power, power in his name. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power, power in his name.
Hallelujah to the King. There is power in the name of Jesus.
Amen. There is power in his name. Would you just pray with me right now? Father, we thank you for the power in the name of Jesus. We thank you for the presence of God that strengthens and equips us. Lord, we thank you right now. Lord, that as we come to you, we pray for needs. Father, I pray for every need that is present in this building. I pray for those that are watching via the internet. I pray, God, that today that you would somehow, Lord, meet their need. I pray for those that need healing. Lord, we just pray for Carrie that you would heal and raise her up in Jesus' name. Father, we pray for Kathy that you would heal and raise her up in Jesus' name. Father, we pray for these today who need a miracle touch, Lord. We ask that you would perform a miracle. Lord, we pray for these who need a financial provision that you would provide for them everything that they need. Lord, we pray for these that are struggling in relational areas, God, that you would help them, oh Lord, to honor you, Lord, and that they would be able to work out those relational difficulties. Father, we thank you because we know that in the power or in the name of Jesus that there is power. Lord, we know that your word declares that at the name of Jesus that every knee will bow and that every tongue would confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And Lord, we pray right now that every problem would bow its knee. Lord, that you would be exalted. Now, Father, these things in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 God bless you. Thank you for praying with us today. You may be seated. At home, you may be seated too if you're not already. All right. Listen, at this time, we have Susie that is going to come. She's going to do our children's lesson. And so, Susie, if you'll go ahead and come and get prepared, then we'll have a great children's lesson. Looking forward to this. And let me see. You want the kids to stay right where they're at, Susie?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. You guys can see okay? All right, good. Do I need to move this for you or you're good? Okay. All right, perfect.
Glad you guys are all here. I've been needing some help with my lessons. I'm going to have you look up the Bible verse for me. All right. We're going to talk about some science today. And how science and God are related. And we're going to talk about how God is the center of our universe. And we're going to talk about gravity and how he pulls all of us toward him, no matter our age, our size, our weight, no matter what we look like. So, Xander, do you want to look up a Bible verse for me? We don't need it quite yet, but I'll let you get started, okay?
Okay.
All right. Can you look up Romans 12:19? Luke and Hannah, I need some helpers. Come here. No! They practiced at home. All right. Cubby, a couple of you want to grab your mask and come on up?
I'll come.
You'll come? Okay, come on up. Come on. You guys can come right up here, too. Come here, Hannah. Come on. You're okay. Grab a couple of things. Grab two things out of this bag. Yep, grab that. You want your rock?
No.
No? How about the ball? drop them down at the same time. See which one's going to hit the ground first. Hold them up. Ready, set, 3, 2. Did you guys see? You flipped it again at the same time. Who's got the next two going? Okay, hold them up. Step right up. Ready, hold them up. 1, ready, 3, 2, 1, drop them.
All right. Thank you, Susie. Yep. Me. What's that? Oh, she left money up here. That's great. Okay, so we had a little bit of a sound issue with With that, Susie wasn't mic'd up, so we apologize about that, but we'll work on that for next week. And so let me just make a little housekeeping announcement right here, and that is for anybody who's doing our children's ministry in the future, because we have several people on the team, make sure you get mic'd up. That will help us out, especially those who are watching live. So let me see. Get the page one. That would be a good place to start, probably, right? Page one. Okay, so listen, we are going to turn to our message today. Let me get things situated here a little bit. And as I said earlier, I'm really excited about this message and believe that it's something that we certainly need to hear today in our culture with everything that's taking place presently. And I believe that it's going to be something that's really going to be encouraging. So, and I like to be reminded that the Holy Spirit, that he encourages us, he challenges us, but he never leaves us challenged. He challenges us and he transforms us. Challenge is just the first step. We all need to be challenged, but God never leaves us just in that place where we've been challenged. Challenge leads to transformation. And I hope that this message will not only challenge you, but the Holy Spirit will use it to transform you. So today we are concluding our series, Infinitely More. We've been working on this series for 7 weeks, leading up to the day of Pentecost. And so I want you today just to imagine with me if followers of Christ had the same encounter that the early church had on the day of Pentecost. Imagine with me if we had a Spirit-led movement in our church, in our city, and in the surrounding communities. Imagine with me as believers who are baptized in the Holy Spirit step into a life that is infinitely more than we might ask or think. One more time, we're going to read our theme verse found in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. And it says, "Now all glory to God who is able through his mighty power at work within us to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think." Now, as we have considered the teachings of Jesus, his miracles and his declarations, and as we have discovered God's plan to help us to live a life beyond anything that we might ask or imagine, that we might ask or think, and as we have learned this one powerful truth, that no matter where you are in your faith journey with Christ, there is still infinitely more to be experienced. You know, in the first message of this series, I said these words. I said that God always has a plan and that he always starts with the end in mind. Since he knows how it's going to end, he starts with the end in mind. And God's divine plan leads us to Jesus, where we find hope, forgiveness, and eternal life. His plan also leads us to the Holy Spirit. Did you know that the Holy Spirit was involved in creation? Did you know that the Holy Spirit was at work in the Old Testament? Did you know that the Old Testament prophet Joel spoke about the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in Joel chapter 2, verses 28 and 29? He wrote these words, "And afterward I will pour out my Spirit on all people. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams, and your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my Spirit in those days." Did you know that Jesus told the disciples that the Holy Spirit would come after he left? John chapter 14, verse 16 and 17 says, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate, and he will never leave you." Verse 17, "He is the Holy Spirit." Did you know that Jesus promised the Holy Spirit before he ascended to heaven? in Luke chapter 24, verse 49, he said these words, "And now I will send the Holy Spirit, just as my Father promised. But stay here in the city," and that city is Jerusalem. "But stay here in the city until the Holy Spirit comes and fills you with power from heaven." Did you know that the heart of God is for you and me to experience the Holy Spirit? We need the Holy Spirit so that we can continue to build the church. That is the mission of Jesus. We need the Holy Spirit so that we can live faith-filled lives until He returns. We need the Holy Spirit to live a Christ-filled life. I want you to get this. As we experience the baptism in the Holy Spirit, our lives change. I think most of us would agree with that. But I want us to think about what happens next. And as our changed lives take place, they're going to change the lives of those around us. Think about it. As the Holy Spirit changes our lives, He changes the lives of those around us through us. What am I saying this morning? I'm saying we need the Holy Spirit. Why? Because the Holy Spirit gives us power. I want you to read along with me in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." I want to highlight, there's so many things in these verses that I'm sharing with you this morning, but this morning I want to highlight two words in this verse, in verse 8. The first word is power. Jesus knows that we need the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Why? So that we can do infinitely more. The power of the Holy Spirit makes us effective. And that's the second word, witnesses, makes us effective witnesses. In a world that is indifferent to the gospel and living in opposition to God's word, Jesus knew that we would need the Holy Spirit to give us courage and clarity in today's culture. You see, the Holy Spirit living inside us, He compels us to tell others about God's plan so that they too can live a life of infinitely more. Let's read Acts chapter 2. We're going to read verses 1 through 4, and then we're going to jump down to verses 14 through 18. On the day of Pentecost, that's the day we're celebrating today. On the day of Pentecost, all believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. Jumping down now to verses 14 through 18. Then Peter stepped forward with the 11 other apostles and shouted to the crowd. Peter stepped up and he spoke up. "Listen carefully, all of you fellow Jews and residents of Jerusalem. Make no mistake about this. These people are not drunk, as some of you are assuming. 9 o'clock in the morning is much too early for that. No, what you see predicted long ago by the prophet Joel. In the last day, God says, I will pour out my spirit upon all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. In those days, I will pour out my spirit even on my servants, men and women alike, and they will prophesy." Well, what do we learn from this passage? Well, there's many things, but one of the big truths is that the Holy Spirit gives us power. I said that the Holy Spirit gives us power. The disciples were praying. I want you to think about this for just a moment. I believe it's so important today. I don't know that I would have thought about this if I hadn't been in the situation that we're in today with COVID-19. It occurred to me as I was reading this passage that there was no pastor present when they received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. There were simply people praying. They were in an attitude of prayer. They were praying. They were seeking God. There was no one there for them to lay their hands on them and to pray for them to receive the Holy Spirit. That's one of the ways that people can receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, is when other people pray for them. It's commonly the way we do it around church. But I want you to think about how important this is today. So many people watching by home who may not have received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You don't have to wait until you come to church and have pastor pray over you, or to have someone pray over you so that you can receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit can visit you right where you are without anyone else present. He can pour out himself upon you. That's what we see happening in these verses. But we see more than that. We see Peter stepping forward with confidence and speaking with clarity about God's plan of salvation to pour out his Spirit on all people. The same Peter, I think this is so amazing, the same Peter who 50 days earlier had denied knowing Jesus now steps forward in confidence and in clarity and the power of the Holy Spirit, and he preaches a great sermon that people respond to. Peter stands up and he speaks up. Now, many of the people there in the crowd, there were some who were insulting these believers. They were saying, these people are drunk. And he's like, you're not drunk as you're assuming. Or they're not drunk as you're assuming. This is that God spoke about through the prophet Joel. The Holy Spirit speaks through Peter. Peter stands up and he speaks up. And he shares the gospel. Did you know that you too can stand up and speak up and share the gospel? I want you to get that down into your heart. Listen, it's not about your own abilities. It's not about you having all the answers. It's about you trusting the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit will give you the words to say. The Holy Spirit will anoint you. You need to learn to trust the Holy Spirit if you're not already, so that you can stand up and speak up. And as I was thinking about this, I thought about these. There's really three steps, three simple steps to sharing your faith in Christ. And it's really evident in these passages. The first thing that you must do is spend time with Jesus. Spend time with Jesus. That's what the disciples did. The second thing, you need to spend some time learning and reading the Word and being taught. That's what the disciples did. They spent time with Jesus, being with Him, but learning what He was teaching. We need to do the same thing. We need to spend time with Jesus. We do that in prayer. We do that by meeting together on Sundays. We do that by learning. We need to learn about Jesus. We do that by studying the Word of God ourselves. We learn about Him by being taught. The disciples did that. The third step is, you need to stand up and speak up. It's simple. Spend time with Jesus. Learn. Learn what He said. Learn what Scripture teaches. And then stand up and speak up. Did you know with those three simple steps, the disciples changed the world? With the power of the Holy Spirit, they change the world. Listen, you can change somebody's world. You can make a difference in someone's life. God can use you. Yes, you. Listen, there's another passage. I wasn't going to refer to this, but it comes to me and I want to share it with you. There's another passage that says this about the disciples. It says that they were in trouble with the Sanhedrin, and the Sanhedrin took note of them. The Sanhedrin were kind of the bad guys at this point. It says they took note that these were unschooled and ordinary men, but they had been with Jesus. I think it's important that Scripture recognizes that these were not scholarly. They were normal people that God used to change the world. And they did that not because of their great intellect, but because of their dependence upon the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's what we need to do. We need to learn to spend time with Jesus, to learn the Word, to be taught by reliable people, and then stand up and speak up. I want you to notice the results in Acts chapter 2, verse 41, when Peter stood up and when he spoke up. Here's what it says, Acts chapter 2, verse 41. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. Thousands of people heard the message and decided to follow Jesus. And that's when the church was born. Pentecost is the birthday of the church. Happy birthday to you. Okay, I won't sing. But it's the birthday of the church. That's when the church began. And the Bible says 3,000 people were added to the church. That is the power of the Holy Spirit who touched the hearts and the minds of those people who were present. They were saved. They were born again. And that's amazing. But I want you to understand something, because I think it's a tremendous help to us. And it's this: not everybody who heard the message got saved. Why is that helpful? Because everyone that you share the gospel with won't respond. And the church moved forward with those who responded. That's our response as well, isn't it? There will be people who won't respond. There will be people who will say no to Jesus. Don't worry about it. Move forward with those who do. Keep teaching. Keep encouraging. Let me say it another way. Stand up and speak up, because some will hear and some will respond. Don't focus on those who don't. Don't worry about those who don't respond. Just stand up and speak up and allow the power of the Holy Spirit to help you be a witness, just like Acts chapter 1, verse 8 says. Now listen, not only does the Holy Spirit give us the power to be witnesses, the second thing that he does is he gives us spiritual gifts. We see that in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 8 through 11. To the one there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom, to another a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by that one Spirit, to another miraculous powers, to another prophecy, to another distinguishing between spirits, to another speaking in different kinds of tongues, and to still another the interpretation of tongues. All of these are the work of the one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one, notice this, just as he determines. The Holy Spirit is the one who determines what gifts that he uses you in. The Holy Spirit gives us power, but he gives us gifts as well to use so that we can communicate God's heart and God's plan to the world. These spiritual gifts are a supernatural work of the Holy Spirit. These spiritual gifts are for every believer. If you have given your life to Christ, God has given you a spiritual gift, at least one, probably more, but at least one spiritual gift. The Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit are not reserved for pastors or the spiritual elite. The gifts of the Spirit are for every person who follows Christ. And let me tell you an important factor about the spiritual gifts. They are given for service, for you to serve, for you to serve in the church, for you to serve in your community. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are not given to make us bigger stars, but they're given to make us better servants. Amen. The gifts of the Spirit are not given to make us stars. Woo! Look at me. I am so amazing. That's not it. To be better servants. To serve. Jesus said that he came to serve. We too should come to serve one another. To serve in our local church and to serve in our community. We don't hoard the gifts. We partner with the Holy Spirit so that we can share an infinitely more life with a world that needs to know God's great plan of hope and salvation and redemption. I want you to understand this morning that the day of Pentecost wasn't about making a lot of noise and drawing attention to Christians. The day of Pentecost is about empowering us as followers of Christ to draw attention to Christ, not to ourselves. I want you to understand this morning that because the Holy Spirit lives in us and because he has given us gifts, that we can live lives that will point others to Christ. Our responsibility, our opportunity to point others to Christ, to help them grow, to help them understand what it means to live a life of infinitely more. Such a sacred trust that God has given us to share that message. Did you know that we are deliverers of God's message? Did you know that we are deliverers of God's message? And I don't know about you, but when it comes to deliveries, I like mine to be on time. How many of you like your deliveries to be late? I saw you raise your hand. You're like, I didn't know you were going to say that. Yeah. Yeah. Those of you who are watching on the internet, there are some people raising their hand. They like their deliveries to be late. So just, you know, I can tell you who that was if you want to put some money in the offering or something. But I want you to think about that. I hate late deliveries. I order stuff from Amazon. It says it's going to be here on a certain day. I expect it to be here on a certain day. I send a gift to someone, to my son out in, where's he at now? Iowa. I forgot where he's at. Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. Sorry, I know it's one of those. It started with an I and ended with an A, one of those states. And I expect him to get it on time. I read about this postal worker. He was too stressed by his job, and so he rented a storage unit. And he didn't feel like he could get all of his deliveries made, and so he rented this storage unit for $49 a month, and he started putting his excess deliveries in the storage unit. Things like bank statements. Things like statements from the IRS, statements from the credit card companies, important deliveries that needed to be made among the 5,000 items that he had in his storage locker, in his storage unit. There were birthday gifts, things that people had sent to other people, and they never got the delivery. Folks, that can't be us. That can't be us. We can't be the people who are hoarding gifts. We can't be the people who are withholding what other people need, what other people are counting on. We have to be the people who are empowered by the Holy Spirit and gifted by the Holy Spirit and who are making sure that people receive what God has gifted to them, what God has given to them. We can't delay the delivery. There are people who are waiting to hear the message that God has sent. We must be those people. Now, here's the good news. God isn't pressuring us to share the message. He has simply empowered us to share a great message of hope. And so here's the big question that you might be asking yourself today. How do I receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit? First, I believe it's important to remember that the Holy Spirit is a free gift to everyone who has decided to follow Jesus. If you have surrendered your life to Christ, then the baptism of the Holy Spirit is for you. Second, we need to understand that it's God's desire that each of us be baptized in the Holy Spirit. God wants every person to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. The third thing we need to understand is that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is initially evidenced by a sign that we call speaking in tongues or speaking in other languages. When people are baptized in the Holy Spirit, they begin to worship God in a heavenly language. Remember what I read a moment ago in Acts chapter 2, verse 4. I want to read it to you one more time. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit. I want you to notice, first of all, there were 120 people in the upper room. We didn't read that. That's other reading that took place before this. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit. Everyone present. There were none who were not filled. God wants this for everyone. The second thing we notice in that passage is not only were they filled with the Spirit, but they began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them the ability. The Holy Spirit gave the ability. When you're filled and you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, you will speak in other languages, and it will be the Holy Spirit doing that, not something you have to do on your own. We also see the same thing some years later when the Apostle Peter went to the home of Cornelius to share the good news with him and with his family. Here's what Acts chapter 10, verses 44 through 46 say. Even as Peter was saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell upon those who were listening to the message. The Jewish believers who came with Peter were amazed that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles too. For they heard them, here it is, speaking in other tongues and praising God. These believers, even though many years had passed between the two experiences, experienced the same thing that Peter experienced and the 120 experienced on the day of Pentecost. They were speaking in tongues. Now let me conclude with this reminder today. The Bible encourages us to be filled with the Spirit, not just for a moment, not just a one-time event, but to continuously be filled on a continual basis. We should constantly be being filled with the Holy Spirit. Why? So that we can live a life of infinitely more. We should be seeking to be filled with the Holy Spirit every day as a constant way of life. Through the work of the Holy Spirit, we are empowered to serve and to share with others. I like what A.W. Tozer said. He said, when we have the Holy Spirit, we have all that is needed to be all that God desires us to be. Boy, I love that. When we have the Holy Spirit, we have all that is needed to be all that God desires us to be. And I would add, and we can do all that God asks us to do. We can be His witnesses. I want to encourage you today as I bring this message to a close to spend time this week seeking afresh and anew the Holy Spirit. Perhaps today you're sitting here in the service, you're watching on the internet. Maybe you've been filled with the Holy Spirit. I want to encourage you to seek Him deeply this week. Perhaps you've never been filled. I encourage you to be seeking Him this week. Remember, you don't have to have a pastor present for you to be filled. God can do it wherever you are, whenever you're ready. I'm going to invite those who are here today to stand, if you would, please. And we're going to dismiss today in prayer. Would you bow your heads and your heart with me today? Father, today we ask first and foremost that those who might be watching via the internet, Lord, that they would surrender their lives to Christ. Any of those present here today, that they would surrender their lives to You. And Lord, we pray today for those who need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. God, that You would fill them. Whether it's here or whether it's at home, Lord, whether they're watching via the internet, Lord, that You would fill them with the Holy Spirit. And Father, I pray for these that, Lord, need to discover their gifts, the gifts of the Spirit that You have poured out upon them. Lord, I pray that they would discover those and be open to being used by the Holy Spirit. Now, Father, we thank You for these things, and we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here today. You are dismissed. Thank you for watching via the internet. Please join us next Sunday. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you soon face to face.